Good morning. Today's scripture reading is from the book of Job, a great poetic narrative that describes what most everybody goes through in life, namely that we have terrible troubles that hit us from time to time, perhaps an illness, the loss of a child, the loss of a job. Why do these things happen to us? The book of Job unravels. The book of Job unravels that question. The story goes that God looked around at all of God's creation and had a conversation with Satan, the tester. That's what that means, the tester. And Satan said, well, Job has it all. If you took it all away from him, what would you have left then? And God says, well, let's just test that premise. I'm reading from the 24th chapter of Job and the 31st chapter. This is long into Job's complaint to his friends about what God has done to him or what has befallen him. Job, being a righteous and upright person, wonders, why did this happen to me? But then in the 24th chapter, Job begins to shift his complaint. This is what he says, and I am heavily editing the book of Job. Why doesn't God pay attention to what's going on these days? And why do those who actually know God never see hide nor hair from him? The wicked seize other people's flocks and pasture them. They drive away the donkey of the orphan. They take the widow's ox. They push people in their way off the road. The wicked snatch the orphan child from the breast and take as a promissory note the infant of the poor, who go about naked, without clothing, and though hungry, they're the ones who carry food for the wicked. And get this, they tread the wine presses, and yet those poor people suffer from thirst. From the city, the dying groan and the throat of the wounded cry for help. Yet God pays no attention to their prayer. The murderer rises at dusk to kill the poor and the needy, and in the night is like a thief. The eye of the adulterer also waits for the twilight, saying, no eye is going to see me. And he hides in the shadows and disguises his face. They harm the childless woman and do no good to the widow, and yet God gives wicked people security and support. And if that is not so, who among you will prove me a liar? Who will show me that I'm talking trash? If I have withheld anything that the poor desired, or have caused the eyes of the widow to fail, or have eaten my morsel alone, and the orphan has gone hungry. If I have seen anyone perish for lack of clothing, and who was not warmed with the fleece of my sheep, if I have raised my hand against the orphan, then let my shoulder fall from my May my shoulder blade fall from my shoulder and let my arm be broken from its socket. If I have made gold my trust or called fine gold my confidence, if I have rejoiced because my wealth was great or because my hand had gotten much, this would be an iniquity to be punished by the judges, for I should have been false to God above. But I have not rejoiced at the ruin of those who hated me. I have not exulted when evil overtook them. I have not cursed them. This is my word, so let God answer me. If my enemy were to swear out an indictment on me, I would carry that indictment on my shoulder for everyone to see. I would bind it on me like a crown. And then I would give God an account of all my steps. And proudly I would show God my record of righteousness. And with that, Job finished his case before God. And he didn't have anything else to say. Friends, listen. God is still speaking, and we are still listening. Now, you could belittlingly say Job wasn't a happy camper, but that would not only insult Job, but desecrate his righteous fury, telling you he's so furious he throws out anyone who comes to comfort him. And by any measure of common sense, Job had a right to be furious. Once king of the hill, now he's dead broke. Once a man who had it all, like E.A. Robinson's Richard Cory, to the nth degree, power, grace, style. Now Job is a street person with not a penny to his name. Yesterday he was marathon man. Today he's knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. Once the Lollapalooza, the bomb, the dandy of every social event, now he has absolutely no control over anything. And so Job sits griping and arguing. It just ain't fair. And he carries on like that for days, for weeks. And then, quoting Joseph Heller, something happened. Job realizes, hey, I'm not alone in all this. Sure, the rug got yanked from beneath me, but lots of people never have a rug to stand on in the first place. And they get the rug yanked daily. Other people who have it all sometimes lose their health, finances, status. I'm not so all alone. Job's personal complaint changes to a social complaint. He sees other people, some elbow to elbow, suffering not one iota differently than he does. Job's complaint and his fury shift from personal to social. And then something else happens. Up to a point, he's focused on the age-old question, why do bad things happen to good people, and I'm as good as they get, which in fact is probably the case. But now in the middle of his earthquake, as a poor person, the question shifts from, why did bad things happen to me? I've done nothing wrong, to why do bad things happen to anybody? And that's when Job goes nuclear. What's with scoundrels, really nasty people, getting away with everything from unearned success to cheating others, burglary, robbery? And by the way, as a side note, didn't we just see this, you and I, didn't we just see this in Georgia this last week? And what about outright murder? To our criminal justice system oriented towards protecting Caucasians more than anybody else. And forget it if you're anything else, or if you're wealthy, the law is on your side. No, it just ain't right. And for Job, it ain't right turns more than just, it ain't right for me. For Job, it ain't right becomes systematic, social, all-encompassing, which ticks him off all the more. Tell me something. Tell me this. Can you think of even one thread throughout our entire Bible receiving more attention than the situation, "It ain't right"? Doesn't it show up all through our Judeo-Christian scriptures and witness that "it ain't right, ain't right"? But on top of that, injustice not just for one person, but for everybody is a deep concern of any God worthy of our calling that God our God. Job may have been a good man before his fall, but Job had to get chopped off at the knees himself to realize what it does to others. Job speaks to me. Oh, yes, he does. He does. While I've scraped the edges short of money a time or two in my life, I've always had, and always known that I've had, a safety net. My family, resources, and education have always shored me up, even in the back of my mind, and I've never experienced the utter hopelessness and despair that others have known and know and will know to the end of their lives. And to boot, if you hadn't noticed, I'm white. And I'm a man, yes I am, yes I am. And I'm hetero, which historically is a leg up. And if you don't know that's true, you don't know nothing. And I've got a job. I'm employed, and I'm married to a wonderful, loving woman, and I've got a personality type that just won't quit even when the chips are down. Just ask my wonderful and loving wife about that. It drives her bonkers much of the time. Here's the thing. I did not one blessed thing to deserve my safety net and my fortunes. You know what I am? You know who I am? I'm Payden in the film Silverado. Lucky. I'm also Job before the fall, which I hope doesn't happen, but I figure one of these days it will, and I'd be advised to pay attention. Of late, Annette and I have had some renovations done at our house, and we both became fond of one of the craftsmen, Daniel, who not only did exceedingly excellent work, but had a great gift of gab and humor, personal connection, and to boot, he brought his cute-as-a-button girlfriend on the job to help him out, and you could just see, just as plain as anything, even no matter what they did to hide it, their sideways smiles and touches. Daniel, a treasure. And I set up an interview with one of our community development builders for him to snag a really big contract. Last week, his boss called. Daniel was dead. Someone found his body behind an old building in an empty lot amongst some cinder blocks and weeds and fire ant mounds. The EMTs couldn't touch him until the police got there because a syringe was sticking out of his arm, heroin. And while I felt deep loss at losing Daniel, moreover what his family and close friends experienced, what could I possibly know? What could I possibly know about what roadmap steered Daniel into that empty lot? Are you, am I, of a mind to say, "Hey, Daniel wrote his own ticket. He got what he did to himself. You make your bed and you lie in it," and leave it at that? And then go back to watching Wheel of Fortune. But what about the world and the cycle of poverty and ignorance and lack of a safety net that Daniel got handed him? He didn't ask for that any more than I got handed the fortunes that came my way. And here's the thing. Privilege never protected Daniel from anything. He was born into soul-crushing exhaustion, and both situation and choices, shaped in measure by his situation, combined to make carbon 21, hydrogen 23, nitrogen, oxygen 5, heroin, his destiny, and he's no exception. While privilege protects so many people from empty back lots and weeds and bricks and fire ants, and also digs chasms cutting others off from understanding or empathizing with the chaotic, cruel, exhausting, mind and heart deadening circumstances, it blocks us from really understanding, except on the far off horizon, in the distance, the soul and mind crushing weight that befalls people without privilege and class. And our God has testified in our Bible, shatters this disparity. If you, my people, want to have anything to do with me, your God, you'll have nothing to do with that chasm between privilege and non-privilege, wealth and poverty. And Job eventually gets it. Did not the God who made me in the womb make them? Did not one God fashion us in the womb? And with that, he himself connects himself with others. What separates humanity by class and education and wealth and gender and sexual orientation and nation, and he really understands the shaky skeleton of bridge girders reaching from privilege to non-privilege. And in righteous fury, Job yanks the rug from beneath anyone, you, me, anyone who would dare scapegoat someone else. Don't blame me for your lot in life. I recall another who rejected, "Don't blame me for your problems." Jesus, whose conclusion about the question of whether God cares about all God's people focused on the argumentative premise, get this, if you did it to the least of people, the sick, the hungry, the poor, the lame, you did it for me, meaning for the enhancement of God's realm. And that premise, combined with the premise, God is a God of justice and mercy, become the well from which emerges the conclusion, those who care for others are part and parcel of God's nature and being. Did you get a hold of that syllogism? Try it another way. Love of God, love of neighbor, same thing. Don't even try to split them or cast one higher than the other. Love of God, love of neighbor, same exact thing. I don't know where I heard this. It's been a long time ago. But someone pointed out that a wide gap exists between understanding the difference between charity and justice. Fine observation. Charity, on the one hand, usually gets cast from high to low, haves to have-nots, privilege to non-privilege, whereas, on the other hand, justice casts itself laterally. Justice is not about charity, unless charity is aimed towards justice. Justice doesn't serve charity. It's the other way around. Justice is the objective. Justice is the aim of charity. And while being generous and charitable to others do fill bellies and provide shelter, charity alone can sometimes be a ruse to keep injustice, you know, off over yonder, to make sure that the bridge across the chasm is a one-way corridor, us to them, of course, never them to us or us together. Because otherwise, everyone might stand to be a citizen of God's realm, and you can bet that the status quo wants no part of that. Of late, the status quo, as you know full well, prefers keeping those kinds of people on the other side of walls to their own devices in the middle of this pandemic as well, because what could possibly matter more to Americans than profits? Let's not dilly-dally with long beards and long phrases and long faces. Pursuing justice is integral to our Christian faith. Charity is fine, and it is a clear road sign towards justice, but in no way does charity complete justice. Any community of faith claiming to be Christian dares not proclaim to do so in good faith without engaging itself at its core roots in its worship, its fellowship, its life, and its relations in pursuit of justice. Anything less well, call it what you want. But the term Christian doesn't belong in whatever it is that you call it. Justice is our raison d'être, our mission, our reason to be, our job in everything that we do. We may not, and we need not, go through the hell that Job went through, but by God, our commission, our charter of salvation is to identify with the hells that others live: racism, homophobia, poverty, hunger, homelessness, political injustice, nationalism. Charitable sentiment is one thing. Charitable generosity is another, but neither substitutes for justice. Charity is a cover charge at the banquet of justice. Would you think kindly on Daniel, his family, his love, his loves, his friends? And would you think kindly on, well, maybe not all the world's Daniels, that's probably more than one soul could possibly bear. But you know Daniels and Job's, you do. You think you could do that? Think on them kindly. Would you be willing to stretch thinking kindly on Daniel beyond "there but for fortune go you or I," towards investing your life towards justice? Would you? Could you? Of course you can. Of course you can. A moment ago I stated that charity is a cover charge at the banquet of justice. Yes. Yes, that's right. Would you care to take a guess who the maitre d' at that banquet of justice is? Amen. Let us pray. Blessed are they who give without expecting even thanks in return, for they shall be abundantly rewarded. Blessed are they who translate every good thing they know into action, for even higher truths shall be revealed to them. Blessed are they who do God's will without asking to see results, for great shall be their recompense. Blessed are they who love and trust their fellow beings, for they shall reach the good in people and receive a loving response. Blessed are they who have seen reality, for they know not the garment of clay, but that which activates the garment of clay is real and indestructible. Blessed are they who see the change we call death as a liberation from the limitations of this earth life, for they shall rejoice with their loved ones who make the glorious transition. Blessed are they who, after dedicating their lives and thereby receiving a blessing, have the courage and faith to surmount the difficulties of the path ahead, for they shall receive a second blessing. Blessed are they who advance towards the spiritual path without the selfish motivations of seeking inner peace, for they shall find it. And blessed are they who, instead of trying to batter down the gates of God's realm, approach those gates humbly and lovingly and in purity, for they shall pass right through. Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. Lead us from death to life, from falsehood to truth. Lead us from despair to hope, from fear to trust. Lead us from hate to love, from war to peace. And let peace fill our heart, our world, our universe. In God and through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
They say that Richard Cory owns one half of this old town, with political connections to spread his wealth around. Born into society, a banker's only child, he had everything a man could want: power, grace, and style. But I work in his factory, and I curse the life I'm living, and I curse my poverty. And I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be Richard Cory. The papers print his picture almost everywhere he goes. Richard Cory at the opera, Richard Cory at a show, and the rumor of his parties and the orgies on his yacht. Oh, he surely must be happy with everything he's got. But I work in his factory, and I curse the life I'm living, and I curse my poverty. And I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be Richard Cory. He freely gave to charity, he had the common touch, and they were grateful for his patronage, and they thanked him very much. So my mind was filled with wonder when the evening headlines read that Richard Cory went home last night and put a bullet through his head. But I work in his factory, and I curse the life I'm living, and I curse my poverty. And I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be, oh, I wish that I could be Richard Cory. And they thanked him very much.